solve. But if it is a practical circuit that I am constructing in the lab and trying to understand it, I need to consider parallel, I mean series circuit of this resistance and a source here, right? So it is by hypothesis to explain the observations that I have in the laboratory. For example, this is a battery source, practical one, having internal resistance R. What will be the current flowing through this circuit? What will be the current flowing through this circuit? Let us say this voltage is 1 volt and this resistance is 10 ohms. What will be the current flowing through this circuit? No current. Why there is no current? Because there is no loop. No closed loop. Current can flow only when it's a closed loop, isn't it? Now, when you observe your torch, torch will have this kind of a circuit. Right? This is a bulb. This bulb will glow when I press this switch. When I press this switch, what happens? There is a closed loop coming in picture. Since there is a loop coming in picture, current will exist. If I switch this particular button off, what will happen? No current. Bulb won't glow. Why there is no current? Because the resistance across this point is infinity. Very large value. Infinity. Since it is infinity, current through this resistance will be zero. And this off switch circuit is as good as this much part. And since this much part is not a closed loop, no current. If there is no current, what is the power consumption? V into I. Voltage V is 1 volt multiplied by 0 ampere. So 0 watts. No voltage, I mean voltage is there, but there is no current, so no power consumption. If there is no power consumption, it is 0 ohms, right? 0 watts. And that's why, if you keep a battery as it is in the air, it will not glow or it will not become dead. It will leak out. It will leak out, and since it is leaking out, it will get destroyed on its own. But it will not be dead because of electrical reasons. It will be dead because of some other chemical reasons. For electrical reasons, it will be dead only when you short circuit it. If you short circuit it like this, then yes, definitely there will be current flowing through. And this current I will be given by 1 volt divided by internal resistance R. And soon, within 1 hour or so, it will be dead. It will be gone. Life will be very, very small. Short circuit the battery and it will be dead in no time. Don't short circuit that battery and it will be alive for very long duration. At least it will not die because of electrical reasons. It will die for some other reasons. Same thing goes when I have a current source with resistance in parallel. There will be a current flowing through that resistance and voltage available across it, but it will not be used by outside circuit because there is nothing connected from outside. The moment something is connected from outside, there will be a voltage coming out. And since voltage is finite, not zero, the formula will not be zero power and you will have energy available in that current source. Have I made myself clear? So, this is something about ideal current source and practical current source. Let us take some more example. And that example is parallel and serial connections. You know, when I have a resistance R1 and I am connecting that resistance R2 in series with, the effective resistance will be series combination of the two. And therefore, the effective resistance R effective will be equal to R1 plus R2. If I have two resistances R1 and if I am connecting another resistance R2 in parallel with that, the effective resistance R effective will be given out by R1 parallel R2, which is equal to R1 R2 divided by R1 plus R2. Right? So, series formula is R1 plus R2. Parallel formula is product of the two resistances divided by addition of the two resistances. Now, supposing I have one more resistance R3 in parallel here and one more resistance in series parallel out over here. So, what will be the change in the formula? R effective in series will be simply R1 plus R2 plus R3 and R effective parallel will be R1 R2 R3 divided by R1 plus R2 plus R3. Let me generalize and say that there are n number of resistances R1 plus R1 R2 R3 R4 R5 ... RN, and for that case effective series resistance will be given by, if I extend this logic, it will be given by summation of Ri, where I varies from 1 to n. And parallel combination will be given by product of Ri, where I is from 1 to n, divided by summation of Ri, where I is from 1 to n. This is my general formula that I would be using if I have resistances connected in series and parallel. In series, this is the formula. Summation of all resistances. Simple. And parallel combination is a ratio of product of all resistances divided by summation of all resistances. So, if I continue applying this formula, certain thumb rules come out. And what are those thumb rules? Let us see. Let us say, I have 100 ohms resistance and I am connecting 100 ohms here, another 100 ohms here, another 100 ohms here, and I am continuing with series. So, R effective will be equal to n times R, because these resistances are all same. I am just connecting same resistances in series. if I substitute the R value in my summation formula, then I will have R effective as number of resistances multiplied by value of resistances. For example, 100 ohms, and let us say 4 resistances are connected. So 100 plus 100 plus 100 plus 100 comes out as 400, which is equal to 4 times 100. So there are 4 resistances, so N is 4, value of R is 100 ohms, so it comes out as 400 ohms. If I am connecting them in parallel, for example, I have resistance R, and in parallel I am connecting one more and one more, and all are of same value, R only. So what will be the value of effective resistance? R effective is equal to, what does my formula say? My formula say product of all. So 100 multiplied by 100 multiplied by 100 multiplied by 100 divided by sum of all. So I have 100 plus 100 plus 100 plus 100, right? That means I can write 4 times 100 divided by 4 times 100. Is this right? Sorry. 4 times 100 is in denominator, that's right. But I can write 100 into 100 into 100 into 100. So I have 100 to the power 4. So what is my formula? In general, resistance R to the power N divided by N into resistance R. If I have N number of resistances of same value connected here, I have this particular formula, R to the power N divided by N times that value of resistance. And that will be my final answer for this particular equation. And it's very simple. Remember one thumb rule. If two resistances of same value are connected in parallel, the value of them, effective one, will be half of it. For example, 100 parallel 100, only two you connect. 100 parallel 100. The answer you will get, 100 to power 2 divided by 2 times 100. And answer will come up as 50, half of 100. If you connect 4, then this combination is 50, this combination is again 50, and if you connect 2 such combinations in parallel, it will come out as half of each, that is 25. So in even number, parallel combination is rather easier. You can simply calculate by this particular formula whenever you have same resistances coming in picture. So this is series combination and parallel combination of resistances. What about series and parallel combination of EMF sources? Let us try to see. Let us say I have a battery source of 10 volts connected with another battery source of 5 volts. How much will be the total effective power of this combination? This is a series combination of two batteries. What will be the effective value of this? Please note, I have connected one negative to another positive. And I have one positive coming out effectively, I am observing one negative terminal coming out over here. Flow of electron will be from positive to negative in the first battery, and that direction and the direction of electron flow in another battery is same. If I connect some resistance R across it, current because of the first battery and current because of another battery is in the same direction. So this is series combination of battery in line, in one direction. And therefore, the overall value of the voltage for such combination is given by addition of the two voltages, 10 plus 5. If I am connecting 10 plus 20, it will be 30. And that's what you do. You get your torch. Torch may need 2 cells or 3 cells or 4 cells, depending upon the voltage that you need to lit that bulb. And when you put 2 cells together, you put them in such combination, one negative to another positive. You don't connect ulta. You don't connect negative to negative. But you connect them in series. So series connection of battery will give you this combination, and voltage will be addition of individual voltage. What will happen to internal resistances? This has some internal resistance. This also has some internal resistance. So internal resistances will also add up. They are appearing in series, so they will add up. If internal resistance of this battery is 4 ohms and this battery is 2 ohms, effective internal resistance of this combination will be 4 plus 2 ohms. What happens if I reverse the connection? What I am doing now, I am connecting negative here and positive here. What happens to this type of a combination? How is it? One battery is forcing current clockwise and another battery is forcing current anti-clockwise. The direction of movement of electron because of one battery is in reverse direction of electron flow by another battery. So currents being forced by individual batteries are opposing each other, and since they are opposing each other, effective voltage will be 10 minus 5 volts. In this example, this is 5 volts, this is 10 volts, and it will be equal to 10 minus 5 volts. It will get subtracted. What will happen to internal resistances? They will add up, simple. They will not change. They will add up. And resistance, internal resistance of 10 volt source and internal resistance of 5 volt source, they will add together to have the common internal resistance for both. What is happening here? It's something very strange that we need to really understand. Electron in this particular battery, 10 volts, is flowing from positive to negative. And when the same electron goes through another battery, it is flowing from negative to positive. Isn't it? And I told you, if electron is flowing from positive to negative, gaining some power. Whereas here the electron is moving from negative to positive, that means it is not gaining the power, it is consuming the power. Because of 10 volts, electron is gaining a power, but in the other cell, other battery, when it is moving, it is losing the power. So this particular 5 volt battery is gaining that power from that electron. Electron in 10 volt battery gains a power. When it crosses through another battery, it delivers the power to another battery because it is losing the power. Look at the directions. And since it is so, you say that this 10 volt battery is charging another battery of 5 volts. When your batteries go weak, what do? You charge them. How do you charge them? You force a reverse current through that battery. And how do you force that reverse current through that battery? By applying higher voltage battery across it. Have a look at the battery getting charged for your inverter. Look at the battery getting charged when your car is moving. When your car is moving, the dynamo present in the car is generating enough voltage to force a current through your battery, charging it. And that is what is happening. How would you know which battery is getting charged? By looking at its value. When there is no series connection, how much voltage this battery would provide you out? 5 volts. And how much this battery will provide the voltage out? 10 volts. This 10 volt in magnitude is a larger voltage.